Hello students, I'm your SST teacher. My name is Nisha Mallik and today I'll be taking class 6 subject social science chapter 1 and the topic is when, where and how. So this is the book. Okay, awareness social sciences for class 6. Okay, so we'll move on to the chapter. So the first chapter is when, where and how. Okay, so the first topic is what is history. So we all know that the study of the events that happened in the past in the sequence, okay, that is known as history. So what is history? What is history? History is the study of events that takes place in a sequential manner of the past. Okay. So it tells us about how early humans lived and progressed with the changing time. So what is history? History is the study of events that takes place in a sequential manner, basically of the past, and it tells us about the evolution. Okay, evolution of man from the ancient till today's today. Okay, why do we study history? So now the second point is why do we study history? So the answer is to know about the past, isn't it? So history is important as it helps us to understand how humans have evolved from over a period of time. Okay, so we'll be dealing in points. So the first point is it tells us about the human discovered and invented various things. Okay, so now we will study about why do we study history. So history is important as it helps us to understand about the human beings and how they have evolved from the changing time, from the ancient period till date. Okay, it tells us how humans discovered and invented various things. It tells us about the discovery and invention of the people from the past till the present. Okay, it also tells us about the cultural, social and scientific development which took place with sequential period. Okay, it also tells us about how people explored the world by traveling over thousands of kilometers. It also tells us about the explorations by different people, for example like Marco Polo, then Columbus. They all discovered various different continents, isn't it? And they traveled places. So what happens, it tells us about the people who explored the world by traveling over thousands of kilometers on land and also on water without any map or navigational tools. Okay, history helps us learn from the mistakes of the past and also allows us to take better decisions. So what history helps us in? It helps us in learning from the mistakes that we have made earlier, and it helps us in rectifying those mistakes, and it also allows us to take better decisions in the present and future. Time frame under study. So the earth was formed billion of years ago. Life came into being in various forms slowly and gradually. We all know that life came in various forms slowly and gradually. Scientists believe that the humans came in existence about 2 lakh years ago. Okay. And they believed it took humans several thousands of years to go from living in caves to be living in settlements and towns. Like for example, in ancient period people lived in cages. Okay, but now with the evolving time we have changed our habit. Now what happened, we live in settlements, we made our permanent settlements, and we have towns, cities, mega cities, isn't it? So with passing time everything changed. The study of history is therefore divided into 3 periods. So now we will study about the different periods in history. history is divided into three periods. That is the ancient history, the medieval history, and the modern history. We all know that history is further divided into ancient history, medieval history, and modern history. So we will learn it in details. Okay. In the ancient history, we study the time between 5 lakh BC to 8000 AD. So what is the time frame for the ancient history? It is 5 lakh BC to 800 AD. Okay, so BC and AD are terms which are used to measure the time. BC and AD are terms which helps us in measuring the time period of ancient times. Okay, the birth of Jesus Christ is taken as the reference point. So the birth of Jesus Christ is taken as the reference point from where historians count the dates. Okay. All the dates before the birth of Christ are counted backward and are denoted by the letter BC. Before the birth of Christ, we use BC. Okay. And after the birth of Christ, we use AD. For example, 3000 BC means 3000 years before Christ was born. So what we do, BC we count backward and AD we count forward. So if we say 3000 BC, we say 3000 years before the birth of Christ. Okay, the dates after the birth of Christ is denoted by the letter AD. So AD is after the birth of Christ, which is known as Anno Domini. AD means Anno Domini. This is the full form of AD, and BC is before Christ. It moves backward, and Anno Domini AD moves forward, which means the year of Lord. So AD means the year of Lord. Okay. Nowadays, historians prefer to use the term BCE and CE. Nowadays, we do not use BC and AD. Rather than that, we use BCE and CE. So nowadays, we use BCE and CE instead of BC and AD. So BCE refers to before Common Era. Before Common Era, BCE, and CE is the Common Era. This is same like BC and AD, but the thing is, earlier we used to use BC and AD, but now we use BCE and CE. Okay. To calculate the difference between dates in BCE and CE, we add both the years. Okay, so what do we do? To calculate the difference or the gap between BCE and CE, what do? We add the dates. I'll be showing you one example. Okay, so to understand BCE and CE, the difference, so how we calculate a year using BCE and CE, what we have to do? For example, let us presume an incident occurred 1500 BCE and the similar incident occurred in 1200 CE. Okay, so say for example, any incident occurred 1500 BCE and the same incident occurred 1200 CE. So how we will calculate the years? We will just add this two. That is 2700 years. Okay, so to calculate the time when the event repeated, we have to simply add 1500 of BCE and 1200 of CE. And we know that the incident occurred 2700 years apart. So the gap between these two events was 2700 years. So now we will talk about the geographical framework, how the geographical location helps us in knowing the history better. The geographical location of a place has a huge impact on its history. Factors such as the type of land, the soil, the availability of water, the climate affect human settlement. So what happens? The factors which affect human settlement. Factors. Number one is the land, soil, okay, availability of water, then the climate. These factors help us in the settlements, in finding a settlement. Okay, in India, humans first settled on the bank of the three big rivers. So in India, the human settlement first took place near the river banks, and the three important big rivers during that period of time were the Indus, the Brahmaputra, and the Ganga. So these three mighty rivers, okay, Indian first settlement occurred in these three mighty rivers. Okay, the mighty kingdom like Magadha, okay, emerged in the Indo-Gangetic plains. They settled in these areas due to the following advantages. So what are the advantages due to which they settled around the river banks where the fertile land? Okay, then nearby source of water, availability of water nearby, good climate, and the very important thing, river served as means of transport. So people could travel or move to places or have transportation with the help of river. Himalayas in the north separate India from Central Asia. We know that we have seen the continent Asia, isn't it? So we know that the Himalayas are in the north of India, and from Central Asia it protects us from the cold winds. Okay, and at the same time the passes in the mountains, the different passes in the mountains allow the movement of people, especially the traders and travelers who with the help in the development of trade and exchange of cultures. In the south, we have the long coastline. We have seen the map of India, isn't it? So we have a long coastline in the south, okay, which allows the trade with the Rome, okay, and thus the oceans also helped in the exchange of goods and religious and cultural ideas. So there was an exchange of religion as well as cultural ideas. Exchange of goods and ideas slowly led to the development of civilization and growth of towns and cities. So what happened? Exchange of good also led to the development of civilization, as because there was exchange of ideas of and cultural exchange also. With the passage of time, they developed into huge kingdoms. So now we will learn the reasons for the movement of people, as why people move to different places. Reasons for the movement of people. So why people move from one place to another? People move from place to place for various reasons. The following reasons are: people moved in the search of food. So the first is, people moved in the search of food. People moved in case of natural disasters. So people also moved when there was natural disasters like flood and famines. So people moved in case of natural disaster. Religious leader moved to spread their preachings and teachings. So what did religious leaders do? Religious leaders moved to spread their teachings. Okay. Traders moved to sell their goods and to the far off places. So what did traders do? Traders moved or traveled to sell their goods. Kings send their armies to conquer land for the purpose of war. Okay, kings send their armies. Kings sent armies for the purpose of war or to conquer land. Okay. People travel to discover new lands. The travelers or different people, those who discovered the lands, they used to travel for this purpose also. So people traveled to discover new lands. All this helped in the exchange of ideas and mixing of people and culture. So all this, the traveling or movement of people, what happened? It helped in the exchange of ideas of the people and the mixing of different cultures. So now we will move on to the sources of history. What are the various sources of history? We know that there are various sources of history which helps us in understanding our past, isn't it? So we'll study the sources of history. History is formed on the basis of things which are remnants of the past, which are the remains of the past. Many types of specialists from different fields of work help in understanding the history. There are many people who help us in understanding the history. The archaeologists recover objects by digging objects from sites that get buried under the earth. So what do archaeologists do? Archaeologists recover the objects by digging, okay, and help us in understanding our past. These objects are chemically tested by the scientists. So what happens? The scientists chemically test these artifacts or objects and through the process called carbon dating. Okay, what is carbon dating? It is a technique. by which the age of any past object can be obtained. Okay. Carbon dating is a technique by which the age of any past object can be obtained. Okay, basically the age as how long it in which period it was found, we find the date through the technique called carbon dating. Sociologists then try to connect these things recovered. Okay, what do sociologists do? Sociologists try to connect the tools or the objects which are found with the places where they are found. Okay, so they try to connect things. Okay, and what happened then? Historians record the history in a systematic manner. Then after that, historians, after getting all the clues and information, they record the history in a systematic manner. Scientists believe that humans originated from animals. We all know that we have come or evolved from apes, isn't it? Our ancestors were apes, and slowly and gradually we moved to the present human beings. One wonders how they talked among each other, how they lived together. So we all wonder as how they used to communicate with each other or how they have lived long. So what happens? History helps us in knowing this facts. Okay. So now we will talk about the sources that are used to study history. They are basically divided into three categories, that is the literary, the archaeological, and the accounts of foreign travelers. So sources of history can be divided into three categories. The first is literary sources. Second is archaeological sources. And the third is the accounts of foreign travelers. So this we'll be learning it in details. So sources of history, the first is literary sources. So what are literary sources? Literary sources are the written records which are preserved in the form of manuscripts. Okay, manuscript. Literary sources are written records which are preserved in the form of manuscripts. Okay. So these manuscripts are basically the bark of trees, such as the bark of trees, then leaves such as palm and birch. Okay, then parchments were also source of manuscripts where people used to write. Okay. Over a period of time, these manuscripts got destroyed as they were very fragile, they were very weak, and they could not survive. Okay, that's why they got destroyed or diminished with the passing time. But some of them survived and have been kept in monasteries, temples, or under the care of government. But the ones which have been, which are still so they all are kept in monasteries, temples, and they all are preserved and are kept under government supervision. These manuscripts can be divided into two categories, that is religious and secular. Literary sources can be divided into religious and secular. So, religious sources. The ancient Indian literature were mostly religious in nature and contained no definite date for events. This religious sources did not have any definite date or events. Okay, but are very much important in knowing our past. The ancient Indian literature were mostly religious in nature, okay, but they provide a wealth of information. They were not definite date or events, but they provide us a wealth of knowledge about our ancient society. For example, the Puranas, the Tripitakas, the Veda. The Ramayana and the Mahabharata tells us about the religious sources of history. Then the next is secular. Secular sources. So basically the secular sources are the subjects of the text where grammar, politics, poem, drama, etc. are explained. Okay, so secular sources tells us about the text, basically the grammar, the drama, poetry, okay, politics. It tells us about these things. Okay, for example, the Arthashastra written by Chanakya, the Panini's grammar, the Sangam literature, plays written by Kalidasa, and so on, gives us a glimpse of the life of the people during those period of time. It tells us about the glimpse or the life of the lifestyle of the people of that period of time. Okay, so now we will move on to the archaeological sources. Second is sources of history, that is archaeological source. So archaeology is the study of the remains of the past. So what is archaeology? It is the study of the remains of the past. Archaeologists dig up the earth to search for the remains of the past buried under it. So what do archaeologists do? They visit a site, and they start digging and they find the objects or the various clues related to the past. Their work help us to reconstruct the history of the period when humans did not know how to write. Okay, archaeological sources are far different from that of the literary sources, because in archaeological sources we do not find any written records, but we find clues of the various objects which are discovered by the archaeologists in the form of digging. Okay, they study about the remains of buildings, pottery, weapons, tools, ornaments, bones, grains, remains of plants, etc. Okay, so what do this archaeological sources tells us about? It tells us about the remains of buildings, then pottery, weapons, tools, okay, ornaments, then bones, grains, remains of plants. Okay, it tells us about all this clues. They are broadly divided into the following divisions. Okay, archaeological sources are further divided into inscriptions, coins, monuments or the remains of buildings, artifacts like pottery, sculpture, ornaments, paintings, tools, etc. Okay, so archaeological sources are further divided into inscriptions, coins, monuments and artifacts. So these tells us about the remains in the ancient period of time. So now we will study about the inscriptions. The engravings done on the stones or the stone pillar are known as inscriptions. So what is inscriptions? Inscriptions are records. Inscriptions are records engraved mostly on rocks, stone pillars, walls and on metal slabs. So it is a record which is engraved mostly on rocks and stone pillars. Okay. Inscriptions are the most reliable evidence and the study of inscription is known as epigraphy. So what is epigraphy? It is the study of inscriptions. Okay. Most of the inscriptions have survived as they were written on hard surface. Inscriptions like manuscripts, we know they could not survive as they were very fragile in nature, but these inscriptions survive as because they are written on hard stones. Okay. For example, the inscription of Emperor Ashoka. Emperor Ashoka tells us about his teaching of Dhamma, isn't it? Emperor Ashoka's teaching of Dhamma. He preached Dhamma, isn't it? Through the inscriptions. Most of the inscriptions that are found written is written in different languages. These are Prakrit, Pali, Brahmi, Sanskrit, Telugu and Tamil. So these inscriptions by Emperor Ashoka, the teachings of Dhamma were written in languages called Prakrit, Pali, Brahmi, Sanskrit, Telugu and Tamil. Among the inscriptions found, those of Ashoka by far give the best description about his dreams. The teachings of Dhamma tells us about the description. It gives us a vivid description about his reign or his empire. So next point is coins. Coins. The study of coin is known as numismatics. Numismatics. It is the study of coins. Thousands of ancient Indian coins have been discovered. We know that there are thousands of Indian coins, isn't it? Coins enable us to understand the ruler and the extent of their empire. It also gives us a glimpse about the economic condition of that particular empire. Okay, for example, the gold coin by King Samudragupta, where it is shown that he is playing veena. It tells that it shows the his interest in music. Okay, so now we will talk about the monuments or remains of buildings. Monuments and buildings helps us a lot in knowing our past, isn't it? Monuments consist of buildings, stupas, caves, temples, etc. And the buildings which are of historical importance are known as monuments. What are monuments? Buildings of historical importance or significance are known as monuments. So monuments are in the terms of buildings, stupas, caves, temples, etc. They are immensely valuable as they tell us about the art, different kind of art, architecture, the religion and the cultural life of the people during that particular period of time. Okay, some of the examples are Sanchi Stupa, the Ajanta and Ellora. Okay, the artifacts and other findings. Artifacts. So what are artifacts? Artifacts are basically the objects of the past that were made by human beings of that particular period of time, like ornaments, tools, etc. So these are known as artifacts. The various objects that human made, such as ornaments, toys, tools and pottery, give us a valuable information about them and about their lifestyle, isn't it? So now we'll talk about the accounts of foreign travelers. Foreign travelers also help us a lot in knowing the ancient period, isn't it? A great deal of our knowledge of ancient Indian history is supplemented by the writings of the travelers of that particular period of time. For example, the Indica, written by Megasthenes, gave us a valuable information about the Mauryan Empire. Similarly, the account of Fahine and Hyun Sang tells us about the socio-economic condition of the India in the 5th and 7th century. Okay, history also allows us to learn about how the people lived in the past. It helps us in knowing that how people lived in the past and how they interacted with nature, how they observed, understood the nature and experimented and devised ways to find new ways of life. It encourages us to examine and question the knowledge that we have gained. It helps us in enhancing our knowledge. The study of history makes us understand our present and the mistakes which we have made in the past so that we do not repeat it in the future. So history helps us in making us understand our present better in a manner that we do not repeat the mistakes from the past. So with this, we finish our chapter and we'll move on to the question answers. Thank you. Okay, so we will start with exercise now. A. Choose the correct option. The study of history is divided into option 1, 2 period, 2, 3 period, 3, 4 period and 4, 5 period. The answer is option 2, 3 periods. Okay. The time period for the study of ancient history is 5 lakh BCE to 8000 CE, 5 lakh BCE to 1000 CE, 5 lakh BCE to 1200 CE and none of this. The answer is option 1, 5 lakh BCE to 800 CE. Question number 3 is, the kingdom of Magadha emerged in the option 1, Narmada Valley, 2, Indo-Gangetic Plains, 3, Bank of River Krishna and 4, Bank of Mahanadi River. The answer is the Indo-Gangetic Plain, option 2. Four is, trade with Rome took place through option 1, land route, 2, sea route, 3, both land and sea route, and 4, none of this. The answer is option 2, sea route. Before the invention of paper, people used to write on number 1, palm leaf, 2, peepal leaf, 3, bark of birch trees, 4, both 1 and 3. Okay, so question number 5, answer is 4, both 1 and 3. 6, epigraphy is the study of number 1, coins, manuscripts, inscriptions, artifacts. It is the study of inscriptions. Number 7, inscription of King Ashoka tells us about Dhamma, Buddhism, art of welfare, economic condition. It tells us about Dhamma. The study of coin is called epigraphy, numismatics, carbon dating, anthropology. The answer is numismatics. Indica was written by Kalidasa, Valmiki, Megasthenes, Vyasa. The answer is Megasthenes. So now B, fill in the blanks. The birth of dash is taken as the reference point from where historians count dates. The birth of Christ. Number 2, dash was written by Chanakya, Arthashastra. Study of inscriptions is called epigraphy. Inscriptions of King Dash tells us about his Dhamma, King Ashoka. Question number 5, most of the inscriptions are written in Dash, Dash and Dash languages, Prakrit, Pali and Sanskrit languages. Metals used in the coins tells us about the Dash condition of a particular empire. It tells us about the economic condition of the particular empire. Question number 7, Dash are buildings of historical importance, monuments. 8, Dash was written by Megasthenes, Indica. 9, accounts written by Dash and Dash tells us about the socio-economic and religious situation in India in the 5th and 7th century CE, Fahain and Hyunsang. So now see, state whether true or false. Number 1, all dates after the birth of Christ are counted backward, false. The Himalayas separate India from Europe, false. The Puranas and the Vedas are the example of literary sources, true. Sociologists record the history in a systematic way, false. In one of the gold coins, King Samudragupta is shown playing tabla, false. Accounts of Megasthenes give us valuable information about King Harsha, false. D, name. Okay, we have to name it. Number 1, the people who dig up the earth to find the remains of the past buried under it and study it is archaeologist. The structured study of the events that happened in the past history. The powerful kingdom that emerged in the Indo-Gangetic plains, Magadha. The things commonly written on the bark of the birch tree is manuscript. The person who is shown on the coins playing Veena, Samudragupta. The thing found engraved on the rock pillars are inscriptions. The study of coin is numismatic. The person who wrote Indica is Megasthenes. The people who study inscriptions are epigrapher or epigraphist. So now we will move on to the question answers. So now answer the following questions briefly. Question number 1. Calculate the time period between 460 BCE and 1783 CE. Answer. To calculate the difference between dates in BCE and CE, we add both the years. It tells us how many years were there between these two years. Therefore, the time period between 460 BCE and 1783 CE is calculated as follows. That is 460 BCE plus 1783 CE equals to 2243 years. Hence, we can say that the incident occurred 2243 years apart. Question number 2. What is the significance of the Himalayas in the history of India? Answer. The Himalayas in the north separates India from Central Asia and protects it from cold winds. At the same time, the passes in the mountains allow the movement of the people, especially the traders and travelers, and help in development of trade and exchange of cultures. So now we will move to question number 3. Okay, so question number 3 is, why have many manuscripts not survived? The answer is, over a period of time, manuscripts got destroyed as they were very fragile. Their writings faded with passing time, but those which survived have been kept in monasteries, temples and under government supervision in various museums. Question number 4 is, what is religious literature? Give examples. Answer. Ancient Indian literature were mostly religious in nature and contained no definite date for events, but they provided a wealth of knowledge about our ancient society. For example, the Puranas, the Vedas, the Upanishads, the Tripitakas, etc. Question number 5. Who is an archaeologist? A person who specializes in studying human history from various artifacts obtained from excavation site is an archaeologist. Question number 6. Write down the importance of coins in the study of history. The importance of coins in the study of history are as follows. A. Coins enable us to understand the rulers and extent of his rule. B. Some of the coins are inscribed with the dates or the images of kings. C. Metals used in the coins tells us about the economic condition of a particular empire and their knowledge of metallurgy. So now we will move to question number 7. Okay, so question number 2. Why did early humans settle near the riverbanks? The answer is, the geographical location of a place has a huge impact on its history. Factors such as type of land, soil, availability of water, climate affects the human settlement. Generally, people prefer to live in areas where environment is favorable for living. Hence, early humans settled first near the riverbanks due to the following advantages. A. Fertile land. B. Nearby source of water for their needs. C. Good climate. And D. Rivers served as a means of transport. Question number 3. Give any 3 reasons for the movement of people from one place to another. The answer is, people move from place to place for various reasons. The following reasons can be attributed to the movement of people. A. People moved in search of food and also traveled to discover new lands. B. People moved in case of natural disasters like floods and famines. C. Religious leaders moved to spread their teachings. All these helped in the exchange of ideas and mixing of people and cultures. Now we will move to question number 4. So now question number 4. How do archaeologists, scientists, sociologists and historians help in reconstructing the past? The answer is, many types of specialists from different fields of work help in understanding history. Archaeologists recover objects by digging objects from sites that get buried under the earth. These objects are chemically tested by scientists through a process called carbon dating. Sociologists then connect things recovered in the similar times and locations to see the connections between them and help us to understand how things probably happened. And then historians record the history in a systematic manner so that people could read and understand the past. So the last question is, write down any 4 differences between manuscripts and inscriptions. A manuscript is a handwritten or typewritten document which were written on papers such as papyrus, palm, parchments. An inscription is a text carved on a hard surface, mostly stones, marbles and metals. Number 2. Manuscripts had a short lifetime if they were not well preserved. Inscriptions are durable and no special effort is needed for preservation. 3. Manuscripts are relatively easier to create. Lots of time and effort is taken to create inscription. 4. It is not difficult to alter the writings on a manuscript since they are written on paper. It is difficult to alter the writings on an inscription since they are written on a hard surface like stone. Okay, so now I'll give you homework. Okay, here we have an activity. Prepare a family tree of your family and find for yourself how long back into ancestry you can go. A sample diagram is given below. So this is the activity which you are going to do. Number B. Activity B. This is the activity which you are going to do. Okay. So with this, we complete the first chapter. Thank you. Thank you.